Hello, and welcome to another episode of Second Gen's Liberated Panda, Lightning Strikes Twice, with my co-host, Christoph, or as you may know him as, Lale. Say hi, Lale.
Hello, what's up, Lale?
And me, Angel, the other co-host. So today, Christoph and I, we want to talk about something a little bit somber. And it's about what happened to that 17-year-old student in Chengdu, Sichuan province in China. So Lale is going to give us some background, some context to the story, and he's also going to provide us some updates. And then we'll discuss a couple of things that Lale and I are feeling as a result of this story. So go ahead, Lale. Why don't you provide our viewers the background for the story?
Where do I start? So this kind of thing isn't unusual anywhere, not in China, not in Germany, not in the US, not here in Georgia. Sometimes kids, they die while they're still in school, or they take their own lives while they're still in school. Just sometimes these things in China, they blow up and they become like this huge topic for a while. And this happened with this kid. So there's this 17-year-old boy who was found dead at the bottom of a building of his school in Chengdu in Sichuan. Then there was this huge scandal that kind of came from that, where suddenly there were internet postings apparently by his mom, who said she was notified 2 hours after they found the body, and then she wasn't allowed to see the body. And there were rumors that he had already been cremated very early without the parents being able to see the body. And it just kind of spun from there. Like, people would add different rumors and say, I'm a fellow student and I know this, or I'm the dad and I know this. A fellow student, was it really the dad? But they just kept piling on until eventually it became this huge thing on Chinese social media, where like this whole hashtag, Chengdu 49中, this school, the 49th school in Chengdu, became like this topic. And there was even a little kind of a protest outside of the school where people actually went to the gate and demanded the truth, because all of these different variations of the truth were out there floating around. And it seemed like it could have been anything. It could have been a very complex murder. It could have been an accident. It could have been suicide. But it seemed fishy to everybody. So this is what it was like 3 days ago.
Mm-hmm. Right. So yes, right when the story came out, it was very fishy. The school was not being transparent at all, would not release any footage, kind of even put a gag order on the rest of the students, wouldn't let the other students talk about what happened. So yes, the entire thing seemed very suspicious. And, you know, as a mother myself, I mean, I would absolutely want to know what happened to my kid. I mean, Christoph, I know you have, Lale, I know you have like an update for us, because there's been like all these crazy to non-crazy controversies surrounding this. So the stories, people have been guessing, people have been like, you know, like you said, it's like a game of telephone, just getting weirder and weirder stories. And then now we finally have the truth. And you were just telling me about the truth. So, so what's the update on the latest?
Well, the truth came out today from the authorities, and there is no reason to doubt it, really. They put out a very detailed timeline of what happened on that night, what happened at 6:10, what happened at 6:15, 6:20, what did the guy do, the kid in question. And they even leaked, I don't know if they gave it officially or if they kind of leaked it to prove their point, but somehow the surveillance footage got to some social media or media accounts. So we have some kind of blurry footage of a few moments of that kid, being just in a terrible state. They say it's because of some relationship issues or whatever, but that's kind of, I mean, it's, then you get into very private stuff once you start talking about this, but it's very obvious he committed suicide. And when I saw the timeline and a few little excerpts from the surveillance footage, it left no doubt this is what actually happened. But like you said, the initial reaction was from the school, from the local authorities, from everybody, was like kind of a, like a knee-jerk reaction, like a reflex even, to cover up. Even if there's nothing, the first thing they have to do is cover up, which really doesn't make any life easier.
Yeah, I find that fascinating that nothing untoward happened. And yet, like, immediately this whole situation was made worse by everybody just shutting down from the school side, you know? So I think it speaks volumes to the type of culture that exists in China. Do you agree?
I think that is interesting indeed. I think it says a lot about the political culture and about the social fabric of China at this point, where the culture has grown over the last decades of CCP rule, where it's really to be expected that whatever happens, if there is even the remote possibility of it affecting somebody in power, there's going to be a cover-up, even if there's nothing. But there has to be a cover-up. And so a lot of the times there might not be anything, but they're going to cover up anyway. And then it's going to seem like there was something. And that just makes people crazy after a while.
Right. That's absolutely true. And you know, like if I were the mom, you know, I would definitely want to know what happened as well. So yes, I mean, we see this time and time again, right? Lale, you know, you see it with the coronavirus, where they hid that because it was part of their culture to do that. And yeah, you know, just with a lot of things in that culture. And it's bad, especially in these types of situations where something like so sensitive is happening. You really don't like living in a society where the main culture is secretive and hiding and all of that. It's just, it can't be good for the psyche. And that kind of like brings me to what I wanted to discuss with you today on the suicide, this unfortunate suicide. And it's like fivefold, actually. When I first heard about this story, you know, I thought I saw five issues here. First issue, I was thinking, you know, they have like such a competitive environment, right? And they're always competing to get into the best elementary school, middle school, all the way up to college. And they're just competing. There's the Gaokao, right? And for those of you in our audience that don't know the Gaokao, like the children in China, they study their entire childhood's way for this one test that determines basically their entire lives professionally. And it also made me think about how seldom depression is discussed and mental health issues is discussed among Asians, especially in China, but also among Chinese Americans as well. And the third thing is bullying. China is notorious for bullying from teachers and students. So I kind of wanted to discuss that as well. And then I have in my notes here, you know, just the systematic issue surrounding mental health and depression. So so maybe we can go through them one by one. Which one of the points I noted like resonates with you like a bit more, Lale?
I think I would actually go back to the last point that we made, where we said there is a culture of covering up and secrecy. And I think I would like to add, and that's why I want to go back to it, I would like to add that this is not entirely only a political CCP thing. I think, and I'm not sure I'm right, but I think it's also a general Chinese culture thing. I don't know if you've seen The Farewell, that movie.
Yes. Fantastic movies. It was really great.
Fantastic. But yeah. But it didn't resonate with Chinese audiences. It resonated it resonated with Asian Americans or with Chinese Americans. It resonated with a few Chinese from China. And it resonated with people like me or with people that just wanted to watch a nice movie, a tearjerker. But it wasn't like a huge success in China, because there is a sort of a cultural gap there. And I think that the concept where the main character is in this conflict where her grandma has terminal cancer and is going to die, but the family keeps the truth from her to kind of make her last days or weeks or whatever, make them bearable and make them nice, just feels really wrong to this Americanized young Chinese woman, right? And right. So she goes through this really strong conflict, but this strong conflict wouldn't really play out in China.
Right.
Where the Chinese viewer would be like, yeah, of course you don't tell her. I'm not saying all of them. Maybe not even, like, especially among young people who've been kind of exposed to Netflix or whatever is on Netflix or our culture or subculture, they might also kind of question these things. But the main culture really says, like, yeah, no, of course you're not going to tell her. Of course you're going to keep that from her. And in that way, you're going to be the possessor of a secret that this person is not getting from you, even though it's your mom or your grandma, which to me as a German person would feel incredibly wrong to keep that from anybody. Like, I know you're dying, but I think you shouldn't know. It's just really odd. Yeah. So I think the CCP does that actually in official propaganda. I remember very vividly a poster I saw at an airport one time where there was a fat baby, and the fat baby said, "Whenever mom scolds me, I repay her in kindness." And it was a CCP poster, and the baby was obviously the population and the mom was the government. So, you know, like, if mom is angry, mom wants good things for you, and you, the baby, the population, kind of not knowing what's good for you and being like in a position where you need to be maybe pushed around a little bit by your parents, you got to repay them in kindness. So this is politically, yes, but also I think culturally. I think there's a lot of kind of keeping things from other people and making decisions for other people. There's a lot of old people in within families being kind of infantilized. Right. Yeah. And so I think this whole culture of secrecy is not only CCP.
You know, it's so interesting that you bring this up, because it bothers me so much, but it's when you're in it, like, you can't, it's hard for you to articulate it, and it's hard for you to even know if it's supposed to bother you. But when you're an outsider and you're explaining it to me, and I see it through your eyes, which is, and I'm like internalizing what you're saying. I'm like, yeah, that is something that Chinese people do culturally. Like, for instance, when my grandfather was dying of colon cancer, we didn't tell him either. So, you know, when we went to visit him on his dying bed, I didn't get to go, but my parents did. They said to him, he was like, oh, this is just a cold, I'm gonna get over it. and he's just like, I don't know why this cold feels so bad. So yes, it's not just about death. You know, in my family, I got to share with you, and I'm a very open person because I'm American, so I just share everything. So, you know, if you have a secret that you need to tell me, you got to tell me it's a secret first. Anyway, so like even within my own family, you know, I'll have like cousins that I grew up with that I consider my sister, and they'll just like sue my ex-boyfriend out of the blue without telling me that I've had for 10 years. And they would do stuff like that. So yes, it is very much part of the culture. Instead of talking and instead of being transparent, they just go and do things. So it's very infuriating. For me, and I'm sure it's even more infuriating for Chinese people in that society. So, go ahead.
In a way, I think both sides have their merits. There is a merit to telling that terminal stage cancer person that they're going to die and say, like, take this truth. You deserve to know this truth. It's your life. I'm not going to make this decision for you to keep it from you. There's merit to that on base of principle. But there's also merit to saying, I will burden the pain for you. I will keep this from you, and I will choke my tears and play happy for you and you will just die without knowing, like basically like a pet, you know, when you take your pet to the vet, you're like holding their hand or their paw and be like, well, go to sleep. They don't know the sleep is going to be it. It's really nice in a way, and it's really harsh in a way, but that's a pet. But you wouldn't do that to a person. Well, sometimes maybe you would. I don't condemn this particular part of Asian culture. Just to me, it's really foreign. I would want to know. I would think this pain is my pain. I want that pain. And I think you deserve to also have the chance to know about these things. But it's not like I don't see the merit. But coming back to the whole thing, I mean, if people do these things in their families and the political party sees themselves as kind of the patriarch of a family of the population, and then installs a culture where the patriarch can never be wrong and everything has to always be covered up, then even things that are not bad will be covered up, because that's how you do it. And that's how we end up in situations where a personal tragedy happens with this little boy, and this tragedy plays out every day in China and every day in the States and every second day or whatever in Germany. I mean, depending on how many people you have and how many young people commit suicide, it's not a thing that doesn't happen. But in that particular instance, and in many instances like it in China, it becomes this huge thing where people go like, what really happened there? What are you covering up? But they're really covering up because that's how they act anyway. That's how they react to anything. And that's I don't think it's healthy.
No, it's absolutely not healthy. And, you know, you say you're so nice, Lale. You say that you don't condemn this. But for me, I absolutely condemn it. I see it in my own culture. I see it in my own extended family. My immediate family, my parents, they absolutely hate it. It's caused so much trouble because people aren't straightforward. People are always hiding things from you. And, you know, you, like 1 year later, 2 years later, there's like a surprise, and it's never a good surprise. It's always like, we need help legally, you know, and lawyer, you know, bailing them out. I condemn it. It's one of the worst things about, I think, Chinese people. I don't know where it comes from. Maybe it comes from like the Cultural Revolution, where like people were scared to talk to each other, like, you know, where children were spying on their parents. Or did it predate that? I don't know. But I absolutely condemn it. So you're too nice. But it's not healthy.
I think the main thing to we have to recognize it, it doesn't come from a place of malice. It comes from a place of kindness, where people say, I want to keep this from you for your sake, and I will deal with the pain. And I think that's in itself, it's a beautiful thing. Whatever happens after is going to be a loss of trust, is going to be just kind of moving the pain backwards, and then the person can deal with it later instead of now. So there is a lot of backlash to it. But I think the initial way of looking at it isn't mean. It's not intended to be bad. It's saying like, grandma is 88, she's going to die in a year. Let's make it a nice year. Why would she go through the agony of knowing she's going to die? This logic is kind of sound, isn't it? But the backlash is bad. I'm sorry?
The grandma, the real grandma from the movie that you're talking about, The Farewell, she ended up living.
Yes, yeah. I mean, I think straightforward Western, if you want to call it even Western, this way is kind of easier to deal with. And it establishes a more fundamental base of trust between people, because you talk to a person and you kind of know that there shouldn't be a huge, huge secret about your own health or about anything other fundamental that they're hiding from you in order to protect you. Maybe they're hiding something from you because they're just cheating on you for whatever mean reasons, but they're not hiding it from you because they think you can't deal with it. I've had these situations a bunch of times where fellow friends of mine, they can't get a hold of their moms in China. And then it's like, well, yeah, she's out, she's hanging out with her friends. And then after, it's like, yeah, she was in the hospital for cancer treatment. And these friends, they cannot deal with their moms not answering the phones anymore, because every time the mom isn't there to answer the phone, that kind of brings back this this what happened before. And it's like, okay, so she must again be in the hospital. Obviously she isn't. She's just out watering the plants. But because you've been cheated this way one time, it just destroys trust completely. So yeah, so I don't think it's very pragmatic.
Yeah, it seemed to like rewire the way that, you know, their brain like associates with it, their mom.
Yeah, it's an association. Yes, if mom didn't answer the phone for a few times, and then you find out she was almost dying, then she better answer the phone every time. Wow. You know, and it makes life really difficult then.
Right. No, definitely. I mean, you go through, you're already like anxious. This is like double anxiety plus like, you know, a little bit of paranoia thrown in there. So not very pleasant at all. No. And I think another reason, like outside of the farewell context, you know, you mentioned that it's like emblematic of society as a whole over there. You know, like I find that like, you know, not only will they not tell you information, like they won't tell you good information or bad information, you know? And when I say they, I mean like my extended family, right? So I would assume that that we can extrapolate that. Maybe we can't, but you know, from my own experience, I can extrapolate that to other Chinese families. And yeah, they just they'll like move and not tell you where they move because they don't want you to know how they're doing until they're like really like set up and like doing well, and then they want you know, stuff like that. Or like they buy a new business but they don't want you to judge it until it's successful, and then something bad happens and I have to fix it. Or like, you know, it's just like, it's like they, like whether good or bad, they like, I feel like that secrecy, the covering up is always there. So
I think this goes to the second point you were mentioning about the problem of kind of mental health in China not being so much taken care of. Like, I mean, psychologists, psychiatrists, therapists, these things, they exist in China, but they don't exist to an extent where it would satisfy the need in the population, especially after the turmoil of the last, I don't know, 70 years or before that. I don't know. Whoever is alive right now in China has been through some things, that's for sure. And I think what we were saying about keeping stuff from people when it's about yourself, a lot of it is also about not showing weakness, not even to your friends and family, you know, like setting up a business and then be like, oh, by the way, I have a successful business, but not being like, by the way, I'm trying to set up something. I don't know if I'm going to fail. Or maybe saying, by the way, I have a physical issue or a mental issue, but I'm trying to take care of it. No, it has to be hidden until it has been taken care of, because you cannot show weakness in the process. And this kind of, I think, is detrimental to the mental health of the population as a whole, because it creates the illusion that everybody's always successful and everybody, like nobody can show weakness. So you're alone with your weakness. Like these kids in school are not only alone in facing the Gaokao, but they're also alone pretty much in facing whatever one faces when one is 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, you know, whatever, how long this phase lasts. For me, it was horrible. I think for many other people, it's horrible. And if the only thing you can turn to is internet novels or some forum boards or chat messages with random friends, but you feel like, actually, I'm really alone and everybody else is kind of an overachiever, and I can't really open up to anybody, that just makes it very difficult. You're just adding pressure on this thing that's already so difficult to deal with, if we're being honest. So I think they're not doing themselves any favors there.
I completely agree. And, you know, I just did a video on this exact issue too, where I was talking up to Asian parents and telling them that, you know, in America, just like, please, like, let them go, do their own thing, let them find themselves, let them be independent. And to your point about like not being, like mental health not being discussed very often over there. It's funny because when I first came to America, even though I was four, I thought it was funny, like comical, that Americans had so many emotions, because in China we didn't like label them. So like when people, you know, when I first heard about depression, when I first heard about like the, you know, rainbow coalition of emotions that you could possibly have. I was just like, this is stuff that Americans made up, you know, like this is like for lack of a better term, white people stuff. I'm like, I don't think any of this is real, you know? And then I grew up and realized it is very much real. It's just, I didn't want to deal with it and no one taught me how to deal with it. And now I'm dealing with it on my own in my 30s, like a lot of Chinese Americans that I speak to. So, yeah.
I think a lot of people in general, not just Chinese Americans, but people in general, it takes time to kind of come to terms with the fact that mental health isn't just something that is there and it's perfect, but it can deteriorate, it can get better, you can take care of it, you can kind of let it wither like a flower and then, you know, it goes bad. These are things that are not entirely clear when you're 18 and you're full of whatever hormones you have at that point and you think like, well, I'm awesome, this is it. No, you gotta take care of yourself.
Let's speak to the Chinese parents out there. Like, what advice would you give them, right? Let's just say hypothetically, I'm asking you as an immigrant that just came to either America or Germany, and I want my kids to thrive, but the only system that I've ever known is the Chinese system. What advice would you give?
Well, I've actually done this with that friend where the mom was in hospital and it turned out later she was in hospital. She was just kind of not answering the phone and it turned out she was in the hospital with cancer. I told my friend to tell the parents to make a deal and say, whatever really bad happens, not everything, you're not going to talk about, I don't know, some issues with your relationship, but whatever is really serious and impacting your life, you're going to share it right away. And this is going to be the pact, that your parents share the next cancer scare and you share whatever scare you have. You're being evicted, you share. You have a mental issue, you share. You're getting divorced, you share. It's not gonna be like they have to worry about these things that you're hiding from them while you're on a Zoom call and you're, you know, kind of smiling at them. So I think making this kind of pact is difficult, especially if you're coming from that culture, but I think it's really a good way to, at least within the sphere of these people, to create a basis where, you know, like, okay, they're not going to lie to me. At least they won't. Not to protect me, not to cheat me, because that's my family. And I think that's something that I would wish for people in general, that they say like, okay, if we're going to talk, I'm going to tell you about the bad things. I think generally there is a lot of fetishization. Is that a word? Like, we're fetishizing white people. You know, we like to look at different cultures and be like, that's kind of awesome about, I don't know, Chinese people. And this is kind of awesome about people from the Philippines or whatever. Let's take that. So we fetishize that. What are they called? The tiger moms?
Yes.
You know, the really tough Asian mom where the kids are like, they play violin and they're also kind of track and field stars and they play chess on a whatever level, grandmaster level, and they're really good at school. I understand that it's really intimidating to have these kids in one's immediate environment and think like, okay, like my shitty little kids have to compete with them. But I don't think never giving them any time off is going to be good for their mental health. I don't think kids should have too much time, but I think they need some time to just be idle and do stupid shit and just kind of hang out. And maybe you're going to come home and your kid is hanging from the couch with a head down and kind of not knowing what's on Netflix, because really life is boring at that point when you're 13 or whatever. Fine. You know, maybe they're outside chasing bugs or whatever. But Chinese people coming from a point where the competition is so brutal, the country is in so much motion and you have to go ahead. You have to get ahead. So you have to put your children through this drill. There's going to be so much damage on these kids where they never have time off. They always have to kind of, I think, prove their worth. Mm-hmm. You know, you're not being loved because you exist. Mm-hmm. Of course you are. I would never say Chinese parents don't love their kids for their existence, but I'm not sure the kids get that. Because if you put all this pressure on them, they're going to think like, well, if I don't like the violin, is my mom still going to like me? You know, of course your mom is going to like you. She's your mom. It doesn't matter how much tiger she is. But I think these things make it very difficult for everybody. So I don't like this whole tiger mom thing, really. Like when we white people, when we fetishize it, I feel like I'm not sure if we know what we're getting into there.
No. Yeah. I mean, it's interesting that it's interesting that you even picked up on that. The whole tiger mom thing and what happened to your kids, you know, what as a result of being under that tutelage, you know what I mean? Like, and not feeling loved, because you're not achieving, because I love my parents. And if they're watching this, I hope they don't think that, you know, they did this to me, but you know, I also felt like I didn't deserve to be loved unless I was achieving, even though they never said it. I don't know why, I just always felt it. So I felt like my entire purpose in life was to make my parents proud and to achieve, so to make them look good. And like, they've never said that to me. I just always felt that burden. I don't know why.
I don't think they would think that. I don't think many Chinese parents would think that of their kids, but it doesn't matter what you think for the kids. It only matters what the kids feel. So
I think a lot of Asian parents do think that though. I think that's
Come on. They're parents. They get a kid and the kid is good for just existing. But they wish things for the kid.
I mean, it's really interesting. We're getting into like something like very nuanced between the way Asian parents and non-Asian parents or Western parents parent. And Asian parents very much like want their kids to succeed, and they get like such a thrill out of telling like their friends that their kids make so, you know, X amount of money, work for X amount of firm. And there's like a Taiwanese culture, my Taiwanese friend was telling me, because I'm not Taiwanese, but there's a Taiwanese culture where you're supposed to kick back X amount of your salary to your parents once you get a job. And they will like the moms will sit around in the backyard and like compare and contrast like how much money they got from their kids. Like, oh, look, don't I have a great kid? Like not this much. So like, I feel like it's very much, you know, like right there in your face that you need to like achieve. Not for all parents, obviously. I'm just saying I think that's where a lot of it comes from. Cause I don't think it's like in the kid's mind. It must have been, you know, projected to them somehow, right?
I think you know, I'm really talking a little bit maybe out of my depth here because I'm not a parent, but I think it's vital for a child for their mental health to feel loved unconditionally. I think that is one of the most vital things, really. And I remember one of my friends has a little boy. He's like 2 or 3 or something. So the boy took a phone and dropped it out of the window of the third floor. So the phone was broken. And my friend who has therapy every whatever week or two went to the therapist and was like, I was really, really angry at that. Like, why would he do that? It was like, not that he dropped it by accident, but he just dropped it. And the therapist was like, look at it this way. Your kid felt safe enough in your home to destroy this thing where he knows exactly how important it is to you. But he feels safe enough because he knows he will be loved anyway. So that's a really beautiful thing. He proved it. And my friend was good. He was like, oh, okay.
Oh, and so your friend is Asian or?
German. I mean, people go through the same issues. You know, some of these things are very fundamental. And it's not like white people don't stress their kids.
No, yeah. But, right. Of course they do. I mean, like it's, you know, parenting is definitely like tough, but I mean, I got to tell you because I'm a single mom and I have a 3-year-old and you know, it's good and bad to be a single mom because I get to raise my kid the way I want to raise my kid. But it's also like when my daughter was born, my extended family that I'm telling you about all the weird stories, that like my cousins, their kids were also born at the same year. So you can see the difference in the way I was raising my daughter versus the way they were raising their daughters. And they were raising them in a very like Asian kind of way, which is, you know, they have to be obedient, wouldn't let them like pick up things to experiment with because they thought it was too dangerous. They were very controlling, wouldn't let the kids like discover things. And then as every time I saw them, you know, the kids went from being like very happy-go-lucky to scared of like things. Mm-hmm. And then like they would like do things that I would not do. Like they want to toughen their kids up. So they would like put their 2-year-old daughter into like a situation where she would have to fight another toddler.
Okay.
Yes, I'm not even joking. I'm not even joking.
A mini Hunger Games?
Yes, I'm not even joking. And this isn't just my extended family. I've heard stories from my friend where her friends make her kids fight each other so they could be more aggressive in school to get ahead and get ahead in life, to get like an aggressive, assertive personality instead of like a Asian meeker personality. That's what they're going for. So that's very strange too.
That is strange. Yeah.
Yes. And it's not anecdotal. It is anecdotal, but I also see it very consistently, you know, in the way I parent and the way they parent. So it makes me wonder. It really makes me wonder for the kids in China, how are they coping and everything, right? Because you were talking about, you know, isn't it nice that to for a kid to be able to get in trouble in front of the parents and they feel safe? And that's exactly what I want to provide for my kids. But you're saying that because the kids in China, they don't have that, your advice to parents would be like, have an open dialogue with your kids, right? That way to come to you.
But there is so much secrecy. There is so much also intergenerational secrets, where people from the generation that lived through the cultural revolution, they're not very likely to share. This is something that is also prominent in the German war generation. Mm-hmm. Like my grandfather never talked to my grandmother about the war. He was in the war. He died later, and I talked to my grandmother. I was like, what did he tell you? Was he in the East? Was he in the West? Did he get involved in anything bad? I mean, it's German Wehrmacht in the war, so, you know, it's not unlikely. And she's like, honestly, he never said a single word about it. So, it's a little bit the same about the Cultural Revolution. It's not like nobody talks ever. That would also be kind of overstating it, but there's a gap in the experience. Like, everything becomes kind of there's like this fog of, let's not talk about this stuff. It's like negative energy, you know, it's what bygones be bygones. And the 80s are a whole different turmoil, not as traumatizing as the Cultural Revolution, but also traumatizing. And again, you don't talk about it. And again, you don't talk about it. And there's always a divide in how generations in China perceive reality. Like, I think young kids right now, I have a much easier time dealing with them because they're not as fascinated with foreigners and they're not as intimidated by foreigners. It's not like they see a foreigner and they go like, oh, you're awesome because you're white. You must be rich or whatever. No, they if they're middle class from Beijing, they can be like, yeah, okay, you're from Italy, you're from Germany. You know, what do I care? I'm kind of the same as you. Makes communicating with them easier. But what do they know about their parents? Nothing. There's a divide there. You don't talk about these things. You don't talk about your own, maybe your failures. You don't share your own fears. Yeah. And then they feel like, okay, am I the only one with failures and fears here? You know, because nobody else has them. My parents don't have them. I'm not supposed to have them. And I think that makes life pretty, pretty tough.
No, it definitely does. And you're right. So I want to first touch upon your point about the Cultural Revolution. I feel like you... And you know, you, Lawrence, and Xiaolei, and know way more about Chinese history and about the Cultural Revolution and about China in general than I do. Like, my parents never discuss it with me. Mm-hmm. And nor do they want to, you know, like I asked them about it and they're like, what about it? When they're like, it happened, you know, and yeah, they're just like, it was fine. So that's the first point. So it's astonishing that I still don't know that much about it. And when I do read about it on my own, I'm just like, it makes me so sad. It makes me want to cry when I look at like all the pictures from back then and my parents saying that it's not that bad. So that there's the trauma right there. And then the other thing that I wanted to kind of like touch upon was the whole thing where like, you know, the parents aren't communicating with the kids. So when I first read the story about the Chengdu, the high school boy who unfortunately killed himself. And the mom was saying like, no, it couldn't be. He was saying happy Mother's Day to me. And he was just like a happy kid going out to school. I sent a happy kid going out that morning. So like, how could he have died? And I was thinking in my mind, you know, because I have depression, my entire life. And it's just like a chemical imbalance. It's not like sadness or anything. It's just, you know, something that I've always had. And I could very much imagine myself going to my mom and saying, you know, bye mom, like all the regular things, nothing out of the ordinary. Yeah. I mean, that's how I would do it too. So like, even before you told me the update about it was conclusively proven that there was no foul play and this was indeed suicide. Like even before you told me that, in my mind, I'm like, you know, I'm like, it could still be suicide, even though the mom doesn't think so, because I don't think parents would know. Right.
Like, yeah. Like, I think it's
America, but like, you know, let alone China.
I think it plays out on a very public stage all the time in America, in Europe, when beloved stars that we have that provide us with entertainment and laughter when they take their own lives. I mean, the most prominent one I can think of is Robin Williams. Yes. So there's this guy who's always making fun and everyone's like, I like that guy. He's kind of funny. And then suddenly he kills himself and we're like, why? You're rich. You're funny. You know, it doesn't, but like, what do we know about his inner feelings? Right. And I think for when society talks about these things, like, for example, Robin Williams, it opens a window of opportunity for other people to say like, well, I'm also maybe impacted. I'm perfectly capable of playing happy or even being happy or feeling happy, but still I'm not really functioning well. And I'm not mentally very stable, you know, and I can share this because there is already like this person, Robin Williams, where I can hitch my cause to them. So that's a good thing. I don't think China is at that point, really. I think it's a discussion that is had to be, that is still there to be had, you know, because the whole country is in still in the convulsions of just economic advancement, and people fall off on the sides, and then people go like, oh, what happened to him? Well, what happened to him? Oh, I don't know, but there's no reckoning, really. So yeah, we're just kind of looking at the victims. Yeah.
Yeah, well, I see China right now as like, you know, do you remember Maslow's pyramid from biology class where you had like existentialism at top and like your basic needs like food, safety, shelter at the bottom? I feel like China, because they haven't gotten like past like maybe the, like even the bottom two, let alone like the top two, that they don't have time to think about mental health. You know what I mean? That's why I was saying earlier that when I first came to America, it just, you know, I was like, wow, this must be an American thing to be able to like to have like emotions and care. And like, and I think it's just because like you have to have all your needs met. And then you start to think about your mental health. I feel like that's the thing that's like relegated to the back. And like you and I have like the luxury of thinking about it and we're lucky. But
I'm sorry, please.
Yeah, no, go ahead.
I was going to disagree.
Oh yeah, go ahead.
I think yes, for large parts of the Chinese population, it's a luxury to even think about, am I happy or not? What's going on? A lot of suicide happened in the countryside because it's just really, really tough there. But also within the middle class, within the upper class, those people who have met their needs objectively, for them, it's also difficult because I think there is the fabric of trust in society is so damaged that you cannot really show any weakness to anybody. You know, like we said before, you set up a business and you can be like, okay, I'm going to wait until that business is really taken off. Then I'm going to talk about it. But I'm not going to walk around and be like, guys, I got mental problems. Where does that leave me? People are going to be like, oh, okay, that's an easy victim. And it's not like they might act on it, but even the possibility of it is just going to leave you very, very scared in China, where people like Jack Ma are not safe. I don't think he's being incarcerated. I don't think he's being intimidated right now. But just for him to kind of, you know, disappear for a while, tells you something. Like if Bill Gates decides to disappear, he probably just doesn't want to be in the limelight right now with his divorce or whatever. I understand. But if you disappear in China as a billionaire and your IPO gets canceled, I'm like, well, okay, you're not very safe, are you? So this feeling of not never being safe makes it very difficult for people to open up about anything. And I actually talked about feeling depressed as well in my Chinese videos. And it took me a long time to even consider doing it because I don't want to talk about myself that much. Like I talk into my phone and I talk about what do I think about the politics or Xi Jinping or whatever, but I really don't feel comfortable sharing too much of my private life. That's just how I am. But with this depressive phase that I'm going through, I felt like a lot of people, they're having a difficult time right now. And it's very difficult to diagnose that maybe what you're currently feeling is a sort of mental instability. And maybe other people are sharing that feeling and you're not alone. And so then I thought, if I have this audience of people that kind of like me or watch me for whatever reasons, I might as well share with them. And then maybe some of them might feel like, okay, that guy with a beard, he has this thing. I got the same thing. I'm not alone. Yeah.
No, it's so, I appreciate you so much for doing that video too. You know, I read some of the comments and I think a lot of people were appreciative. There were like 500 comments, 590 comments. Hope so. I think it's so great that you're talking about it because like I feel like every time I talk to you I feel like I'm in therapy a little bit because
I hope not.
No, but in a very good way because like I feel like I'm able to observe Americans from an outsider perspective, so I'm more objective, but I actually like every like the things that you mentioned are like very much universal to a lot of Chinese people, right? Which includes me. And when you say it, and I'm just like, wow, that's true. That's never occurred to me because, you know, I'm me and I've only lived my life. So when you talk about it, I'm like, I'm definitely going through some emotions inside. I'm like, I feel that. I feel that. He articulated that. And that really resonated with me. And I might go feel depressed and cry later, but that's okay. Recognizing the issue, right?
I'm sorry.
No.
High five.
No, it's great. No, it's great because it's so good to know, like, to be self-aware, to be aware of like how your culture limits you, how your race limits you, you know, how like all of this stuff limits you, and to break free from that. So thank you for doing that for not just me, but for all your, you know, the 33,000 people watching as well, your audience. And I feel like, you know, everybody feels alone, right? And it's nice to have somebody commiserate and validate that, especially if you don't hear it often.
I think this is something that Chinese young people are generally missing. I see a lot of very intimate bonding in these dorm situations or over online games or online chats. There's just this, I think it's also maybe it's even told, maybe I just haven't read it yet, but I was gonna say it's an untold story of loneliness of this whole generation of kids that have no siblings. And then you talk to them and you say like, so what was it like? And they're like, that's my brother, that's my sister. And you're like, oh, they're like your actual siblings? No, they're my cousins. but I made them my siblings because I wanted siblings, and they're kind of the same age. So I made them that, but really they're not that. I got cousins and siblings. It's different. The level of intimacy. And I think all of these things, they compound with a pressure, with a political pressure, with the general feeling of there not being any objective truth anywhere, where as an American, the truth is eroding, I think, because of Trumpism, because of everything that led to Trumpism. It's not like Trumpism came from space. But right. Now when you have people that don't share your truth at all, it just makes it very difficult to even deal with them when they go like, well, you know, the January 6th insurrection didn't happen. Vaccines right. are 5G implants or whatever. How do you talk to a person like that?
Crazy thing.
But imagine being Chinese and you being the crazy one just for thinking that maybe these last 70 years weren't so good. Maybe Mao really did kill tens of millions of people. Maybe really the Cultural Revolution destroyed Chinese culture, like a large part of it. Maybe the Tiananmen thing should be talked about, however you look at it. And maybe there are so many things that are being kept under the rug, but you're the crazy one because everybody looks at you and goes like, ah, you're an anti-vaxxer basically, or you're like, you believe in bending spoons with your mind or whatever, because really most people, they think you're very strange for having these doubts, but you have these doubts. And then, yeah, it gets very lonely, I think. There is no real community for people that feel like maybe this country needs some reckoning again. Yeah.
Yeah.